were your childhood fantasies?
Well, I ain't telling you. My childhood fantasies? I'm not telling you, actually. That's a little too private. As I said before, if I ever write about my sex life, I'm making the money on it. Not Channel 4. Oh, mama, don't be not to use it. Well, if I don't, I'm gonna lose it. Gimme the trouble. Hairspray certainly came from a period of my life. A very weird period, 1962, was right before everything changed. It wasn't yet the 60s, like as you think of the 60s, but it wasn't 50s either. It was this weird little time period that was caught where everything was radically about ready to change, but hadn't yet. Mama told me not to use it, but if I don't, I'm gonna lose it. I'm gonna wrap my hair, they'll be doing the hairspray everywhere. Well, there's the famous shot of the kid, and you'll never get to show it because her estate is very, very picky. I promise you they will never give you the rights to show it. However, it's the one of the kid in the park clutching a hand grenade like this. Well, that picture is exactly how I felt as a child. And I don't mean that badly. That kid's having fun. He's playing and he's trying to scare people and have fun. But I really identified with that picture when I saw it. Oh, I think the kid looks like he's having a great time in that picture. You know, he's hamming it up for Diane Arbus. There was a woman there taking a picture and so he went, hey, look, a hand grenade. I mean, I understand that. I mean, the kid was having fun. The first thing I can remember rebelling about, really, when I was about 8 years old or so, every Sunday in church, once a year, they would read us this pledge that you had to take for the Legion of Decency, which was the Catholic Church rating the movies, what you could see, what you couldn't. And the condemned ones were the word they'd tell us you'd go to hell if you saw these movies. Well, I remember refusing to do this pledge. I mean, my mother was kind of shocked because I was just a child. She didn't make a big deal out of it. But in Sunday school, the nuns would read us this list with this voice, like, from the devil. And they'd, you know, to see this nun stand there saying, love is my profession, mom and dad, the naked knight. I thought, what are these movies? I'd never heard of them. They didn't play in my neighborhood, believe me. But I would go to see them or read about them. Then I would clip the little list and keep a record of what all the condemned movies were. Mom and Dad's hanging right in my hall, the poster for it. I mean, it's still that much of an influence. But it made me want to see these movies that I had never, ever heard of. So, in fact, they encourage me. They're maybe the only people that encourage my interest without ever knowing it completely. I was angry maybe because no one would ever encourage my interest. You know, I knew something was wrong from the beginning. Everything I was interested in, no one else ever was. So I was fairly used to that by the time I started making movies and tried to celebrate that.
Could you give us some of your political beliefs?
Kill everyone now. Condone first-degree murder. Advocate cannibalism. Eat shit. Filth are my politics. Filth is my life. Take whatever you like.
Yes.
My main goal always was to make people laugh. Certainly I knew that the scenes in there were shocking, but people laughed. They didn't just turn their heads in disgust. They might have turned their heads in disgust and laughed. Same way, that movie still works. The time has not mellowed Pink Flamingos, which I'm proud to say. New 17-year-old kids see it and are shocked.
Gentlemen of the press, get ready, because you are about to witness the biggest news event of the year. Live homicide. Connie and Raymond Marble, you have breathed your last breath.
I showed it in what I teach in prison sometimes in Maryland, and my class was all murderers and rapists, and they saw it, and at the end they said, you're really sick. Well, you know, it's really amazing you see what people's limits are. And this, I've always done movies about what are people's limits. And once I made Pink Flamingos, I never tried to go further than that. I knew that I had sort of gone as far as you could go, and there was no, and be funny and clever, hopefully, rather than just disgusting. And I never tried to top that movie, ever, ever, ever. And I think I would, my career would have been over if I had it. She walks by, the men folks get in. It's very touching to me that Divine started his career playing a psychotic and ended playing a loving mother. Never in my films is Divine revealed as a man at the end. I mean, Divine was just a good actor that I usually cast as women.
Mama, welcome to the 60s.
Ch- childhood fears. I'll tell you, my first fear was air raids because of that communist stuff and these ridiculous tests you had to take in school where you put yourself under the desk. Well, every time I had heard an airplane at night, I thought I was going to be killed. That was the first fear I ever remember. My parents put in this fallout shelter. They had the civil defense put the whole thing in. And I would thought, I'm not going down there with them. And little cans you had to take a shit in and stuff with my whole family. I thought, I can't, really. I'd rather be blown up in the war, really, than have to go down there in these little bags. And I saw them and try to picture my whole family taking a shit together for 6 months. In the 60s, I used to say to my father, I'm a communist, just to watch him go berserk. Certainly, I was not a very good communist because I never think that everybody's alike or deserves the same thing. In the beginning, certainly, I looked very different. I had long hair. I looked kind of berserk. And the times were so different that people assume sometimes that we were like the characters in the movie, that that was our life and that is how we lived, which shocked me when people really thought that. You could ask any person over 50 years old in Baltimore, were you a drape or a square? And they don't say, what do you mean, I think? They immediately say, square, drape. It was that divided. Then after that, that's a little before my time, though. You know, next was the period sort of in where Hairspray was, where you were, the girls had big teased hairdos and stuff, but that wasn't a rebellious look. Their mothers had that, too.
You had 3 good close-ups today, period. Why can't you dance up front where the voters can see you?
Don't leave me alone, Mother. I have a pimple.
And you had to choose a color record as your favorite song, didn't you? That's nice for the neighbors. You got something against Connie Francis? Shelley Fabre? I love Shelley Fabre.
Amber! Amber, are you listening to me?
The rebellious look was to not tease your hair, to be a beatnik, to look like Mary and Peter, Paul, and Mary. The first thing I ever wanted to be was a beatnik.
And the fat retard!
I mean, in the first school, we had to take sports. And to this day, I am a sports bigot. If there was a Ku Klux Klan against sports, I would join it. I don't care what happens to OJ. He's a sports figure. They all should be in jail. Every person that ever played sports. And I'm glad to be a spokesman for those people because no one ever says that. And I did this ad in Baltimore saying I hate sports. And ladies would always come up to me in the supermarket and say, I'm glad you said that. I hate them, too. There's really a lot of people that hate it. But it's very un-American to be a man and say that. You know, you get in a taxi here and they say, how about those Baltimore Orioles? I say, what do you think I know about them for? Do I ask him about a Fassbender movie? I didn't get hassled in high school, really, because I could make the people laugh that would beat me up. And that's still how I've gotten through life. Is I never got beat up because I could make them laugh with me against authority before they hit me. That's the secret, really. I was an arty juvenile delinquent, which is different than being a real juvenile delinquent, that I always watched in school, but wasn't one. You know, there was one girl in junior high named Mary Jane was her name, and she was the scariest girl I ever met. And she beat up girls every day. She would stab them with her rat tail comb. But I didn't ever know her, but she knew I watched her. And she knew I was her fan, so every day I would just smile at her and she'd do something bad. And I know it was for me. And so she was a real juvenile delinquent. I was a juvenile delinquent groupie. And then I would sometimes imagine juvenile delinquents and write their little biographies and that kind of thing. Like in, there was a TV show on television that I based Hairspray on called The Buddy Dean Show. And these were kids that came on television every day and danced. But I would imagine their lives and draw them and make up fictitious biographies of crimes they had committed and stuff. So I was more of a juvenile delinquent hag, I think. Then, you know, it was almost politically correct to shoplift. I know that's really hard to imagine. But it was at the height of the Abby Hoffman years. There was a book called Steal This Book. Stealing was then, in the certain places, politically correct. And we were good at it. Divine was really good. I saw Divine walk out of a store with a chainsaw in one hand and a television in another in Provincetown. And no one said anything. My best shoplifting was I went into a store with just a pair of shorts on and a t-shirt, dressed fully in all the clothes, and then applied for a job. Filling out the paperwork with fake names. I almost got the job, too. It was really scary. And I'm sitting there in all the clothes. Right? It's still a good way to do it. No one would ever suspect that. Well, I'll tell you the worst thing I ever did that I never put in my book. And the only one I actually feel guilty about is this. And this is, I can't believe I did this. We were riding around, just joyriding, on Christmas Eve and saw someone go in the house and all their wrapped Christmas presents were in the car, and we stole them and opened them, and the ones we didn't like, we took back. They had gift slips and got the money for them. I think I'll burn in hell for a few days for that.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. Now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe.
Music was the very first way I ever rebelled. I mean, when I first heard Elvis Presley, I levitated. And I collected rock and roll, and I've used it in every one of my movies. Those 45s are right in that bureau, the same ones that are every soundtrack for my movie. And it got on my parents' nerves. It was the first way I figured out how to do it. And, I mean, they heard Little Richard coming out of my bedroom screaming Lucille. It really scared white parents then. And then they saw Little Richard. He's still scary. To me, I met him, I was scared.
Ooh, baby, heaven is up on a night. Yeah.
Music to me was a liberating thing to get away from your parents. Certainly it was black music in Baltimore is what I grew up on. We had three great black radio stations here, WEBB, WSID, and WWIN. And all the cool kids, I thought the Beatles ruined rock and roll to me, because they changed it overnight, the same way Andy Warhol ended abstract expressionism overnight. The girl groups were over with. Motown was dead when the Beatles came out here. So I lost interest in pop music from then until rap.
And I feel the need of you.
It's certainly my memories. When they're walking in the alley and the black guy's walking up singing Nothing Takes the Place of You, well, that's when I grew up at my parents' house. In a very white neighborhood, but there were two blocks that were black, and it was fairly near my house, and at night as a kid I'd lie in bed and I'd hear people walking home at night singing a cappella along, and it was so beautiful to me. The songs I knew from my radio stations.
Again I'll love you, but I'm all alone.
I went almost the other way, where I only had black friends for a period in my life. We went to a record shop, very much like the one Motormouth Mabel's record shop in Hairspray. And the girl that I got beat up with for being my date, her mother owned it. And we knew two other gay guys that were down there. And everybody hung out together. But they wanted to be beatniks too. It was from the beatnik scene. You know, basically, the beatnik scene was very integrated. And you had to listen to jazz and yell out, all right, for no apparent reason. You know, it was part of it. But it was just a different world that we could go to. And a fun one.
What's the problem, officer?
This is a white establishment.
Oh, come on!
Hey, listen, we just came to dance.
That's not fair.
Open your purse, please.
Well, I think in Hairspray, that is when Tracy sort of gets her consciousness. That's when she first rebels against everything that her parents believe in. And I remember seeing it in Baltimore, certainly, where kids would overnight go to especially against Governor Wallace, some sort of rally against blacks where they would march and be booed and spit upon and everything, where it radicalized them forever. And in a great way, I think. But in one night, they would change from just seeing this. And I think that's what happened to the character of Tracy in Hairspray, that overnight, she uses this fame she got through the dance show to go into what the 60s really did become, political. I mean, I got beat up for having a black date at a girl, at an art school here, at a dance. I mean, things here were then, in the early 60s, were very, very racially separated and racially tense, because George Wallace was running for office here, and it was racially tense. It still is, but people just don't have the nerve to say it out loud.
And I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever.
I still have a dream.
Yes.
It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream.
You all together?
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry, but preteen day's a white-only show. Negro day's the end of the month. Now, you can come on in, or you're going to have to get out of the line, all right?
You mean you're going to turn this little girl away?
Look, I don't make the rules, all right? Now, you're going to come on
in. Aren't you aware of the Supreme Court ruling on segregation?
What are you talking about, kid? I just want you to either come in or don't come in, all right?
I have a dream.
You heard the man. You're holding up the line.
Yeah, so segregation never! Integration now! Segregation never! Integration now!
Leave this area immediately!
Leave this area immediately!
There's a whole generation with a new explanation. People in motion.
I would have had no desire to ever go to Woodstock. Sitting in the mud with a bunch of hippies and listening to Joan Baez was never my idea of a good night. But I must admit, when we heard what happened at Altamont, we were sorry we weren't there, which is terrible. I know, because it was a disaster and people were killed. But it sounded more have more of an edge, you know. It was more my kind of night. Cars were sex. Cars was the way to escape your parents.
Kept his stash.
I went to the drive-in every single night for about 2 years. Even in the winter and snowstorms, it was open here. I was arrested in a drive-in once for underage drinking. A lot of things happened to me in the drive-in. Cars were a way you could hear music, the only place where we could go. And one person would drive in, me, in my mother's station wagon, with beer covered by blankets, and then everyone else would sneak in through the woods. And I don't know how they ever didn't know, because I walk in, hi, who would go to the drive-in by themselves except a complete lunatic, really? This drive-in was so good, they even had chairs where if you didn't have a car, you could walk in this drive-in. And there was the saddest people who would go alone and have to stand with the cars in line by themselves walking, and then you sat on this little bench with a speaker. I always really respected people that wanted to go that badly, that would do that, especially in the winter. In Baltimore, the drive-ins were the only place where you could see really exploitation movies. They were movies that only played in drive-ins, and Baltimore was big on that circuit. Certainly I saw Blood Feast. I saw the Russ Meyer movies. I saw all those things at the drive-in.
What you need is a manager. Yeah. 10% of your action be enough for anyone. I never took no course in anatomy. But from what I can see, you got two of everything and some left over.
I don't know what you're training for, but as far as I'm concerned, you're ready.
Look, me Jane, you Tarzan. Now why don't you drop that tree you're holding and let's grab a vine and swing a little, huh?
A huge influence on me, what I used all that knowledge to later turn in my cinematic sense of humor, certainly was formed on that kind of stuff. That wasn't the only movies I saw, but that's all that played in the drive-in. They certainly didn't show Antonioni in the drive-in. The Buddy Dean show went off the air mostly because the white kids' parents wouldn't let them dance with black kids. Not so much the TV station. Just the times were very, very different. But I remember big dances, and it was always with like the Marvelettes or rock and roll groups. It would be great. It was one of the first things I remember got me out of the house. I think in high school, I didn't know any people that were out gay in high school. I didn't know any. I could easily tell who they were. I can look right back through my yearbook and pick you out who they were. And I knew it then, too. But it wasn't talked about then, certainly. It might have been talked about downtown. Certainly, I had been in out gay people's apartment when I was in high school. But I don't think anybody else in my school certainly didn't talk about it, or I didn't know about it. You could tell who was, mostly the teachers. I don't know if I'm going into the first sexual experience. I think I'll make the money off that one, not you. on the first date, actually, I recently met someone who said, you took my sister on her first date, and I remember it too. And I never saw her again. And I said to him, well, what is she like now? And he said, she's fat. Very, very fat. Which kind of made me laugh that her brother would say that. I thought that was odd. But I thought it's in fitting, I guess. You know, I had some good luck with big girls in my movies.
Come on, everybody. Clap your hands. Oh, you're looking good. I'm going to sing my song. It won't take long. We're going to do the twist, and it goes like this. Come on, let's twist again.
Being fat, in a way, has more problems than any other possible minority. And because it's still safe to make fun of them. And so I always had fat people in my movies that didn't think they looked bad, though. They thought they looked great. I still think people that are ugly can be great looking. It's about the confidence you have and how you pull it off is what counts. And I think I showed that in all my movies, that as long as you have style, that's all that matters. You can be ugly, but you have to have style. If you don't have style and you're ugly, it looks really bad. But if you're great looking and have no style, it's even more depressing, I think. So it's just having that style of figuring some look to go with what you have. And that's important, and that does bring you happiness in a John Waters movie, yes.
I am yours, Connie, eternally united to you through an invisible cord of finely woven filth that even God himself could never, ever break.
In the films, I never have normal sex, certainly because sex to me is ludicrous positions. It does look silly. I mean, who thought of that the first time? You know, then I think it was good, whoever did it the first time, but we have to do it, you know, so it is instinct. And how cool can instinct really be? That's what I try to tell kids. Now they can't be promiscuous. I try to think of some way to tell them, you know, so they don't get AIDS and stuff. I say, well, you didn't think it up, so how cool is it anyway? You know, I can't think of any other way to tell kids not to have rampant sex, because that is the right of being young, I think. So in my movie, certainly sex is always almost surreal looking. It's always played for laughs. I love sex, but I didn't think it up. It would be better if I had thought it up. If you thought, well, let's see, if you put this here and you do this, oh, it works. But there isn't some new way that you can do it. I mean, I hear of new ways, but I guess as I get older, I'm not quite that experimental. LSD really changed everything. And my reality was altered heavily in high school. And people say, don't you remember watching television? I said, no, I was on LSD then. I didn't watch television. And I'm not saying, I'm not pro-drugs for kids. If I had a kid and they told me they were taking drugs, I'd be very uptight. I can't be a hypocrite, though. Nothing bad ever happened to me. I haven't taken drugs in 20 years. But however, I don't regret that I did. However, many of the people I took drugs with then are dead from drugs. So it's a subject that I don't want to be hypocritical about. I'm not for drugs. However, I think they can increase your sense of humor.
I think we better get going now. The coast looks clear.
Let's do some reefer.
We'll get high and I'll iron the chick's hair.
Reefer?
Drugs?
Loco weed. When I'm high, I am Odetta. Let's get naked and smoke.
Cool.
Don't breathe it in. You'll be addicted.
But later, sister, later. Much later.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked.
Times were very, very different then. It was much easier. It was cool to be poor. And it isn't now. That's the one thing I don't understand about youth. And when I go to the colleges, tell them, you've got to make it cool to be poor. You should want to be rich at 40, not 20. At 20, you should want to kill the rich. It's a right of youth.
Jacko up the limbo stick, all around the limbo clock. Hey, let's do the limbo.
I watched that tramp, and I'm embarrassed to be white.
You know, Edna, I've been reading about these kids. Maybe Tracy could be some sort of campus leader.
Wilbur, it's the times. They're a changing. Something's blowing in the wind. Fetch me my diet pills, would you, hon?
This creation that we had come up with that was based on his anger, really. His anger of how he was so hassled in high school. And in high school, Divine was a nerd almost. I mean, Divine didn't go out of his house till he was 16. Divine wasn't flamboyant at all. But somehow they knew, and they waited for him every day after school to beat him up. The police took him home. He literally had a police escort, he joked later, through a lot of anger, that they took him home because they had to, because people would wait outside. And they knew that deep down there was divinity was lurking, I think. But certainly that anger helped in teaming up with me, because I gave him an outlet for this anger. And he spoke for my anger, too, everything, through this character that we came up with named Divine.
Could you turn that racket down? I'm trying to iron in here.
You visited Divine's grave?
Well, I certainly go to Divine's grave. And I've seen over the years people leave amazing stuff. I've seen them, they've left boxes of donuts, makeup, a big dress once. Once somebody wrote with lipstick Satan on it, but my friend Pat Moran said they meant satin. They just spelled it wrong. I was out there this week and somebody had left a big pink flamingo, the kind where its wings blow in the wind. I don't know what you call those things. A hypodermic syringe and a bottle of acid that set on it. So God knows what they were doing there. But Divine would like it. He wouldn't care what people are doing. It's so weird when I look back in any of my films and see so many dead people in them. It's very sad because, in a way, it's not sad. At least they're still there in the movie. I met a kid recently who said, we study you in school. You know, I wanted to slip my wrist. But basically, it's very, very different. Certainly when I started out, they would have never let you make those kind of movies in school. You would have failed. It was wrong to like Russ Meyer. It was, you know, you couldn't like this kind of stuff. It wasn't debatable, but now you could do your graduate from NYU and do a movie exactly like that and win praises. Things have very much changed about what is acceptable for humor.
Do you think that reaching those people in that way changed anything?
Well, I always say, if anything, I made trash 1% more respectable. 13 movies, which is an accomplishment I'm proud of.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. Now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoe. Well, you can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. Well, do anything that you want to do, but not, honey, lay off them shoes. And don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoes. Let's go, cat!